Welcome back to the second part of our series on the three imperial cities of Central Europe. In this episode, we stop in the Czech capital, Prague.
We'll take you along with us on the last leg of our Trafalgar guided holiday, which began in Budapest, Hungary. En route to our final destination, in yet another imperial Habsburg capital, the city of Vienna in Austria.
So join us, I'm David Celdran, and this is Executive Class.
Few images of Prague are as memorable as that of the Charles Bridge at daybreak. It's the rare time of day when the medieval stone bridge can be enjoyed without the hordes of tourists blocking the view of the Vltava River and the city beyond. Prague is best known as a city of spires, a name that best describes their majestic skyline with its outline of towers and domes, in styles ranging from Gothic to Baroque. The bridge connects Prague's old town with a castle district, the birthplace of the city, and later the residence of the Holy Roman Emperor Charles IV, after whom the famous bridge was named after. Charles chose Prague as the seat of the vast Germanic Empire, and succeeding emperors, including a new line of Habsburgs, ruled from the castle overlooking the city. The castle, or Hradčany in Czech, now houses the Presidential Palace, Art and History Museums, and one of Central Europe's most impressive Gothic churches, the Cathedral of St. Vitus. Built by Charles IV in 1344, it's one of the many landmarks in the city that reflects the glory of Prague's golden age. It's a marvel of late Gothic architecture, although the construction of the cathedral was only fully completed in the 20th century. There's a fee to go inside, but it's worth the price. The interiors are a fine example of what the Gothic architecture of the age was trying to achieve. The vaulted ceilings and towering stained glass windows communicated the glory of the heavens above and the promise of salvation. Its church service as spectacle, worship as escape. No doubt art enthusiasts will marvel at the stained glass windows, but for history buffs, this is the Piazza de Resistance. It's where the kings, the Bohemian kings and Holy Roman emperors were crowned. Most coronation ceremonies were held here from up until the imperial capital was moved to Vienna. Both kings and saints are buried in St. Vitus, including two of the city's patrons, Saints Wenceslas and John Nepomuk. As a seat of empire, Prague's fortunes grew, and along with it, the city's skyline. A walk back through the old town reveals one of Europe's most magnificently preserved cityscapes. Some of Prague's most important sites are found on the main square, Staré Mesto, the Jan Hus monument built to commemorate the Hussite reform movement. The Gothic Church of Our Lady of Time, with its distinctive twin steeples. And the crowd favorite, Old Town Hall, with its world-famous astronomical clock. Because Prague was never devastated by war, neighborhoods have retained their look and identity over the centuries. One of the best preserved is the Jewish quarter, Josefov, with its eclectic mix of neo-Baroque and Art Nouveau buildings. This part of Prague, the Jewish quarter, is where you'll find many of the most beautiful, the most amazing examples of Art Deco and Art Nouveau buildings. Now, many of these houses still have stained glass in them. We're gonna visit an atelier or studio where they still make stained glass. The atelier of Jirika Kofal is Prague's oldest existing painted glass panel making company. Visitors aren't always allowed here, but with the help of Trafalgar's Prague specialist, Andrei Dubovsky, we were given a rare chance to see this centuries-old craft in person. With hundreds of churches and historical buildings all over Prague, the demand for stained glass remains high, even if very expensive. This workshop produces and restores panels for famous landmarks, like the glass windows we saw earlier in St. Vitus Cathedral. Glass painting and lead embedding is a Czech specialty that goes back to the days of empire. Everything is still made by hand the traditional way from A to Z. A single panel can take up to 2 months to make and cost up to 10,000 euros. Prague was the main source of high culture during Habsburg rule, and even after the empire's demise, the city remained a thriving center of art and literature. But after World War II, the communist government suppressed civil liberties and the arts, forcing writers like Václav Havel and Milan Kundera underground or to live in exile.
One of the things that attracts most about Prague is the intellectual spirit of the city. We're here in the Vineyards district to meet one of my personal heroes. She's a playwright and a former dissident who took part in the Velvet Revolution of 1989.
Like many intellectuals critical of Soviet-style socialism, Petrushka Shustova was imprisoned for her views in the late 60s. With Andrei as my fixer and translator, we meet to chat about politics, literature, and post-communist Central Europe. She recounts the days of their struggle for democracy in the former Czechoslovakia, and how finally, in 1989, hundreds of thousands of Czechs gathered in Wenceslas Square to oust the communists in a peaceful act of protest known as the Velvet Revolution.
It wasn't operated, orchestrated, organized. It was just simply they started up something and tried to see how many people will take a part in it. And people were coming in, avalanche effect. It starts rolling as a little stone and the ball grows. More and more people saw that basically if you step out against the regime, nobody kills you.
With fellow dissident and playwright Václav Havel in power, political rights and artistic freedoms were restored, and protest literature, once banned, resurfaced to influence a new generation of writers.
And the basic question is that
the cafes and pubs of Prague today are an exciting place to see locals debate about society and politics. It's a popular pastime here, that's accompanied by another favorite one, beer. So we're told that the Czechs drink more beer than any other nation in the world. We're here to ask a master brewer why that is and how they make their beer differently from the rest of the world. Pivovarský Dům is one of many microbreweries in Prague. The owner says all the beer served here is freshly made here, in-house, and in plain sight of customers. Beer, or pivo, as it's known here, is a large part of Czech culture. Historical records show that the first brewery was founded in the 10th century in Bohemia, the old name of the Czech Republic. Pilsen, the world's most famous type of beer, originated in the Czech town of Pilsen, near Prague.
How many glasses of beer do Czechs drink in a day?
Very traditional style in the Czech Republic is to meet together and drink in the pub, similar, mm-hmm. or still worse. And this style is to sit by friends and make a joke, oh, okay. Entertainment, yeah. All right. And by this occasion, used to drink people, four, five, a half liter beers.
Okay, let's try it. Where do you think I should start?
I would prefer to start with our Pils original.
The most typical Czech beer is made from yeast, and it's gold in color. But new varieties are being brewed to appeal to younger drinkers, women and foreigners. This sampler includes dark malt beer, light wheat beer, and beers flavored with chili pepper, cherry, and banana extract. Most Czechs still prefer their beer the old-fashioned way, always best enjoyed in the atmosphere of a traditional pub. Scenes like this make Prague seem rather folksy, but there are fine dining options as well.
Nice, fancy place. Apparently it's been around since the 17th century.
U Cisaru, or at the Emperor's, is a restaurant fit for a Habsburg king indeed. The mansion dates back to 1673, and the interiors are filled with weaponry and trophies from that era. Converted into an upscale restaurant, it's a cozy place to escape the typical pub fare of fried pork, dumplings, sauerkraut, and beer. Dining at a castle district is a unique way to experience Prague after dark, and Trafalgar includes this, plus another local tradition, a tram ride, as part of its tour of the city at night.
This is really cool. It's a private tram, just for us.
The first electric trams appeared in 1891, and next to the subway, they're the fastest way around, and the most scenic too. We start our final trek through the old town at Republic Square, where two famous landmarks of the city stand. The Municipal House, done in grand Art Nouveau style, and the Gothic Powder Gate, one of 13 fortified entrances that used to ring the old town. Down through Cheletna Street, one sees the merry mix of architectural styles that give Prague its distinct identity, and further towards the old town square, with its eerie, Kafkaesque glow at night. The brooding novelist Franz Kafka was a native of Prague. He wrote, "Prague never lets you go. The little mother has claws." I always found that quote intriguing, but here, walking through his city at night, it occurs to me what he meant. Prague never lets you go. Not the memory, at least. It took me 24 years to return, yet it seems just as I last left it. Up next, we hit the road again en route to our final destination, the imperial capital of Vienna, in Austria. That's up next when Executive Class returns. Welcome back to the final leg of our journey en route to Vienna, the last imperial city in our Central Europe itinerary. To break the 6-hour trip over land, Trafalgar adds a stopover in the city of Tabor. Historic Tabor is one of the many charming medieval towns that dot the Czech countryside. But it's more than just a pleasant rest stop between Prague and Vienna. Tabor was a stronghold of the first Christian Reform movement to seriously challenge the Catholic Holy Roman Empire.
Apparently, the Czech Republic has a long history of underground movements. In fact, the first one dates all the way back to the 14th century. These were the Hussites.
Besieged by Catholic armies, Hussites retreated to secret tunnels like these. Miles of tunnels still exist under the old town. A small section was left open for visitors to see.
It wasn't just rebels who used these tunnels. Entire families also needed them for temporary shelter.
In case of fire or war, the tunnels could accommodate whole neighborhoods, even animals for months. You could travel from one part of town to the other entirely underground.
And here we are in a different side of town.
After taking in the main sights of Tabor, we're back on the road to Vienna. This part of Europe today is a borderless community, just as it was under the 600-year reign of the Habsburgs, when countries like Austria, Hungary, Czech, and Slovakia were all part of a single entity administered from Vienna. Now the capital of modern-day Austria, the vestiges of empire still stand proudly in the historic heart of Vienna. Most of the imperial monuments and buildings are along the Ringstrasse, the wide circular road built by Emperor Franz Josef and where the old city walls once stood. The grandest of all is the Hofburg Palace, the official residence of Habsburg emperors since the 15th century. The vast complex of 18 wings and 2,600 rooms now houses the office of the Austrian president, various museums and galleries, and the world-famous Spanish Riding School. Hero Square was once the parade ground of victorious imperial armies. Less heroic was Hitler, an Austrian, who delivered one of his infamous speeches here. During the summer, the Habsburgs preferred the Schönbrunn, a palatial estate the size of Monaco on the city's fringe. Like the Hofburg, the Schönbrunn today is a museum dedicated to Habsburg history, and to one famous woman in particular, Maria Theresa, the first and only empress of the dynasty. The Schönbrunn was Empress Maria Theresa's favorite palace. She was an empress who was besieged on all fronts by enemies. Surely she found a patch of peace in the summer palace. For her military daring, her administrative reforms, and her patronage of the arts, Maria Theresa is one of Austria's most admired monarchs, and her summer palace, the beloved symbol of her glorious 40-year reign. The last Habsburg emperor was forced to abdicate after Austria's defeat in World War I, but the family left behind an imperial city that remains among the most sophisticated in Europe. Vienna is known for its quality of life. The city tops global surveys as the most livable and innovative. It's recognized as a capital of classical music and opera, science and medicine, design and architecture. Artists and thinkers like Mahler, Freud, and Klimt lived and thrived in the liberal and multicultural atmosphere of Vienna, an intellectual legacy that lives on in the modern city, and in the many traditional coffee houses that have defined Vienna for more than a century. Cafe culture is a central aspect of life in Vienna. It's listed by UNESCO as an intangible cultural heritage. The cornerstone of a fine coffee house was its cakes and pastries. The Sacher Torte of the Café Sacher was, and still is, the city's most famous delicacy. I'm told the cake was created by a chef named Franz Sacher for the emperor's chief minister. It was a big hit in 19th century Vienna, and still is today.
Ingredients are different than maybe 100 years ago, but the recipe is exactly the same. And I think the trick of the cake is the topping, the chocolate itself. It consists of three different kinds of chocolate, and this is the secret of the cake.
Is it a secret recipe, or because I know people can taste it, and over the years they've been able to deconstruct it and recreate it, or is it still something like a family secret?
It is a family secret, which is, I think, only 3 or 4 people knows the original recipe, and it's in the safe.
Only cakes by the Sacher Hotel can use the name Sacher Torte, so beware of copies. The original is a combination of 2 layers of soft and light chocolate cake, separated by apricot jam and coated with chocolate. It's best eaten with unsweetened fresh whipped cream.
You must eat the cake with a cream for maximum effect. Now that is Viennese luxury.
The Viennese also love their coffee. They've invented more than a dozen varieties. The Hotel Sacher was built in 1874 with a fortune made from selling their famous cakes. Under its new owners, the hotel is now one of Vienna's leading luxury hotels, with a long list of VIPs that count celebrities, artists, and heads of state.
That's the Emperor's signature. Hillary Clinton. She was still first lady, I suppose. For VIPs.
An entire wing of the iconic building is dedicated to the autographs and photos of famous guests of the hotel.
Surely they were very important people during their time, but I don't think you'll recognize anyone on this wall. But perhaps you will on this one. Luciano Pavarotti, of course. Jose Carrera, Leonard Bernstein. You have practically every big opera and classical music star that ever existed. They've been to the Hotel Sacher, and of course the Café Sacher, because it's right across the opera house.
Stars of ballet and opera are loyal guests of the Sacher, especially since the hotel stands right next door to the Staatsoper, Vienna's preeminent theater. Vienna is called the city of music for a reason. Many of the world's greatest classical conductors and composers spent time in the city writing music. Built in 1861, the State Opera House was where the compositions of greats like Mozart, Schubert, and Mahler came to life. Their music still fills the halls of the auditorium today. This is such a rare privilege. The opera is about to begin in just a couple of hours, and here we are seeing everything pretty much in the raw. This is a premier opera house, not just in Austria, some would say the entire world. You can request Trafalgar to arrange a special tour of the opera house, including parts of the building inaccessible to most ticket holders. The best seats in the house were reserved for the emperor and his family. To celebrate the opening of the new opera house, Mozart premiered his Don Giovanni opera. Of course, the emperor sat here. Apparently, he loved the opera, but he hated the opera house. You know what happened? The architect found out, and he later killed himself. He was so devastated with the news. But it's beautiful. It's really beautiful. The performances at the Staatsoper are always sold out. They advise booking a year in advance. But if you can't wait that long, the city is full of other concert halls to choose from, like the historic Palais Auersberg, which even offers dinner before the show.
This is a really interesting hall. It was here where the 6-year-old Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was discovered by the Empress Maria Theresa. And this hall over here was named after her, Maria Theresa.
Not only Mozart, Joseph Haydn, Willibald Gluck, Franz Schubert, Beethoven, Gustav Mahler, Franz Liszt, Strauss, Zierer, Lanner, all these important composers and musicians, they lived here in this palace, they worked here as concertmaster and as music teacher for the family of Auersberg, and of course, all of them played a lot of concerts in the Rosenkavalier Hall, where you will see tonight our Vienna Residence Orchestra.
This was once a salon where the aristocratic Auersbergs and their guests were entertained by Europe's best. It's a setting for an authentic Viennese supper, featuring local favorites like Wiener Schnitzel, which is fried and lightly breaded veal, and Apfelstrudel, a pastry of apples, raisins, cinnamon, and icing sugar. If dinner is the appetizer, then the live concert is the main course, with a Viennese residence orchestra performing well-loved classics by Austrian composers. There's chamber music, excerpts from an opera, even some ballet. They say the Habsburgs were far better in developing the arts than they were with administering their empire. By the end of the First World War, what was once the Austro-Hungarian Empire was broken up into the various states of Central Europe today. Tiny and neutral Austria is a shadow of its imperial self, but her legacy in the region's cultural life looms large. You see it, above all, in their lust for life, the good life, which travelers to the former empire can still relive today. And that's our series on the imperial cities of Central Europe. I'm David Celdran. Thanks for watching.